You clearly don't know who you're talking to. So let me clue you in. I am not in danger, Skyler. I am the danger. A guy opens his door and gets shot, and you think that of me? No. I am the one who knocks. I am Lou Diamond.
Want to learn from those that are taking their lives, their businesses, and their passions to the next level? Best-selling author of Master the Art of Connecting and professional speaker Lou Diamond is here to connect you to some of the most inspiring and amazing people on the planet. Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
Welcome, everyone, to another spectacular episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting into the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond. Today on Thrive Loud, we have the Turnaround Mastermind. She's a Wall Street Journal and USA Today bestselling author, has been a CEO of several organizations, former U.S. ambassador, U.N. delegate, and advisor to Fortune 500 companies. Throughout her amazing career, she has orchestrated and executed the successful turnarounds of well-known private and public organizations in all industries and sectors. Her ability to tackle different issues directly with discipline and diplomacy is why she is here on Thrive Loud today. Thrive Loud listeners, Lisa Gable. Lisa, how are you today?
I am doing great. How are you?
Well, talking to you is an honor and I am spectacular. And I know our listeners are truly going to love our conversation here. And I'm going to just jump right to it. And this is, there's an art of what you do. And the ability to turn something around means that you have to have jumped in when it was going in the wrong direction. So without going all the way back to the womb, Lisa, I would love to know, when did you realize like this was kind of your superpower, the ability to change, adjust, and help people move onward and upward?
Yeah, you definitely. I tell people I'm the Hail Mary pass, which is that in most situations I get called into, it's when a philanthropist or a CEO has tried something over and over again. They've tried lots of different methodologies. They've tried lots of different people. And they're really at a critical point where they're wondering, do we shut this thing down or do we give it one more try? And let's go with somebody that's going to do things very differently than anyone else has. And I guess the place I realized that this was my superpower is at Intel. I was recruited from the White House, the Reagan White House, I'm old, into Intel Corporation by Craig Barrett, who would later become the CEO and chairman of the board. And I was Craig's troubleshooter. And so what he would do is he would send me out to figure out what went wrong in a thing that was driving him crazy. And so one of those areas was Intel's engagement in K through 12 education and the STEM curriculum within schools. And that is very popular. And everybody goes, well, that's not a big deal. But you've got to understand in 1989, 1990, we didn't have corporate social responsibility. We didn't have corporate foundations. That was all brand new. And so Craig sent me out to figure out, you know, what it was that Intel could do better and what was going on in the schools. And some of the programs we developed ended up being used in various books and Newsweek as sort of prototypes that people have built on today. So the other place where he brought me in is that Intel had lost its first consumer trademark. For people that have been in Silicon Valley for a long time, they may remember that there were these billboards and they were the 286 with a big red X through them, 386. And it was the way that Intel was trying to explain to consumers that they should understand the brains of their computer in order to make a purchasing decision. Again, commonplace today, no one else had done it before. And They went through a 7-year lawsuit. They lost access to that trademark. And so they wanted to understand, what did we do wrong? They were getting ready to spend billions of dollars on the Intel Inside program to launch it, and they didn't want to screw up again. So I took that concept and I just basically power used my turnaround abilities throughout Silicon Valley for the next 15 years and then later in government philanthropy.
I love it. And thank you for the recap and bringing things to where we're at. Let's talk about when you get in. People get set, whether they're even doing something wrong or changes need to be made, change is hard. And recognizing what the change is and then getting people to follow and go down that direction. From a leadership point of view, Lisa, maybe share a little bit of your process or the way that you begin to start to recognize like what the turnaround needs to be. Because by the way, like you made a good point. Sometimes it is a Hail Mary and this things could really be going wrong and it might be something to run away from. You seem to love this challenge, I imagine. So I'd love to hear maybe your process and how you get things started.
What I ask people is, what do you want to see? Just visualize the future. Tell me from a visual example, exactly what you want the world to look like. And then what we do is we audit the past. We basically go and we break down everything that the organization has been doing. We build stacks and we say, okay, in this particular stack, what's going on in this silo? What's going on in that silo? And we break down different processes, systems, decision-making capabilities, where they're making their investments. And to build our path to the future, we essentially look at each item and we compare it to our perfect future, right? If we do these things, will it enable us to get to our perfect future, or have we been focused on the wrong thing? And one thing I learned at Intel and I talk a lot about is Andy Grove had something called Job One. And if you've ever read anything that he wrote, he was the CEO of Intel, Time Magazine, Man of the Year, is he said, you've really got to focus on job one. And is what's the most important thing you can do? If everything goes to hell in a handbasket and you don't have a lot of money, you don't have a lot of resources, there's got to be this one thing that's going to get you to that perfect future. And so we try to find that one thing. And I actually added to Andy's philosophy, and I had jobs two and three, and I called them the backup singers, you know, to your main singer. What are those one and two other things that you need to do that are going to help drive job one forward? And finally, once you've made all those decisions, stop questioning yourself. You've gone through this extensive process. You've really analyzed everything. Now it's time to execute with speed, confidence, agility, and heart. You want to move quickly. You've got to stop the paralysis from analysis. You've made all the decisions. You've had the systems to get you there. And you are just running as fast as you can to move forward. And you're doing that because you don't have a lot of time left.
Yeah. Getting the leader to understand that concept and the recognition of the change that needs to be made, and then getting others to follow through to make the change happen. Two different types of skill sets. And there's the strategy of coming up with that right direction and where to go to turn things around. And now there's the follow through. Can you talk a little bit about, from a communication point of view, from a leadership style, from how to message and how to get everyone on board to at least give this change a go?
Well, I use a lot of shuttle diplomacy. And what I mean by that, and we've seen Zelensky do this in a way that is completely awe-inspiring, which is I go to person after person. I sit down at their desk. I talk through with them what the audit showed us, where we're trying to go. I try to explain within their vernacular, that using their language, why things that we've done before, things that they care about, aren't going to get us to where we need to go. And through that process, help them engage in the future forward mechanism. And let's be honest, not everybody wants to engage. Not everybody's going to agree with you. And some people have a hard time letting things go. But by honoring them, by showing them the respect of sitting down with them and listening to them, and then articulating what they just said back to them and said, I know this is what you want, but it's not getting us there. And here's the data. Always speak with facts. Have the quantitative data that backs up your arguments. Then frame for them why we need to do a pivot, why we need to do a change, why we need to go in a new direction. And people will lay down their weapons. That's always my favorite time is, you know, they're out there fighting you. It's always difficult at the beginning. I'm going to be honest about it. People aren't happy. But if you can go through this process, you use facts, you use data, you show them respect, they'll lay down their weapons and they'll move forward with you.
You have a breadth of experience in your career of dealing with from political organizations, political entities, profitable organizations, nonprofit organizations, these different hats you wear obviously are tremendously different organizations, but do you see them any differently in the way you approach your work? Yeah, sure.
I don't, because it always takes money. It takes money. revenue, the creation of revenue or the influxion of cash is always a requirement. Secondarily is government, business, philanthropy, they all have a customer base. For the government, you have taxpayers. The way the government gets money is if the taxpayer agrees to give you that money for a particular purpose. That's why we have campaigns. That's why we live in a democracy. Business is the same way. It's a return, you know, it's ROI. What's your return on investment? Are you giving the customer and the shareholder what they want? Same thing with nonprofits.
Providing advice, which is something that you've been doing a lot of your work now of late because you're advisors to different companies versus the actual leading role and being the point person to be dealing with that. I'd love to understand like your preference with this. I know that's probably changed over time, but I think our listeners would love to know, for somebody that's had such a breadth in her career, which hat do you like wearing the best? The person who's in charge or helping those who are in charge?
Well, I like being in charge. I'm not going to pretend that I don't. I do, but I've been a CEO 3 times and I've been a CEO since 2004. And, you know, I'm at a stage in life where I believe so strongly in the potential of what I call open markets and free people in capitalism, that I feel as if I'm at a stage in life where I need to build the next generation. And so I'm very much, even when I'm being brought in right now, and I've recently been helping with building a climate tech fund, I'm not the person leading that building effort. But what I've been trying to do is introduce the person who is to my extensive network, help them identify people in industry that would have to adapt and modify and bring in the technology that they'll be investing in, help them understand why that industry has certain questions, what their needs are, basically give them the tools that they need to solve a very important and complex process. And so I have changed my direction because I did retire in January. And now I'm also at SMU as an entrepreneur in residence. I really want to grow the next generation. I believe so strongly in the opportunities that we have that I want to make sure they continue for my children and grandchildren.
For the last 30 years of your experience in business here, there's been a lot of changes, even in the way work is being done. Obviously, the fast forward button was tremendously hit during the pandemic. I actually would like to hear this because I do know that that window of time when you took on the most recent responsibility that you had required a change and an adjustment. Think of the views of how business has changed over the time and maybe what you like most about where things are headed, or maybe what you miss most about where things are going.
Well, I think part of what's happening is we've been seeing over the last 10 years that due to the rapid acceleration of technology and scientific innovation, that the time periods in which you have to make changes within an organization or a company and achieve the objectives is getting tighter and tighter. It's happening more frequently. And what you discover is that people are very uncomfortable with that. I love change. I love change. I seek out change. The average bear does not like change so much. Part of it is, even when I did the last turnaround, which was a medical research organization, we did an 83% restructure and we raised $75 million in the first 18 months of that turnaround. We accomplished those objectives. We were in California in late January 2020, and we were on our way to raise $125 million. $150 million. And I felt very confident that we would do so. And then boom, you just took an organization through a restructure. We hadn't even hired in the necessary people to run the organization in the way that it would fit the future forward. And the pandemic hit. And so we were doing all of these things simultaneously, which was trying to uplevel the organization, trying to hire people, and doing it within really the most restrictive time period. But we're now back into people wanting to go back into work, people that are heavily engaged in trying to rebuild their companies and get them back to where everyone wants the world to be. And lo and behold, we have a war. So it is a very complex time. And I do, again, feel like I've been put in this place at this specific time to help other people solve the problems. And I am am very dedicated to doing it, and I'm doing it across a wide spectrum of areas, because to move quickly, people need resources. They don't know where they are. I've been around for 40 years. I can help people network to the right resource.
In addition to the whirlwind of activity that you've done over the last few years, you've also brought a message to the world here in your book, Turnaround. First of all, was this something that had been brewing in you for a very long time? And pulling that together, I love asking authors this question. The writing process for you, was it like, you know, birthing a child, or was it something that just was really easy to flow through and come out of you?
Well, I had not been considering it, and I have a personal PR person that I've been working with for a number of years that I just keep on a personal retainer, and she wanted me to do it. And so she introduces me to the publisher in about, I want to say March, February timeframe of 2020. And he said, and I had been thinking about something around leadership and character, because it was a very prominent conversation during that election time period, secondarily, because I've worked with so many famous people and people who've had such distinct impact around the world. He said, look, Lisa, people are going to need to do turnarounds when they come out of the pandemic. Could you instead refocus and write a book on turnaround? So be me, I do everything very quickly. And he said, by the way, I said, well, when does the book have to be finished? He goes, well, I think we need to launch it around September, October of 2021. So I'll need it from you by January 1st. And it was like, okay, let's do all this. I basically wrote the entire book on Saturdays and Sundays from 7 a.m. until 4 p.m. from Labor Day through December 31st. And I met with my editor every night at 6:30. And remember, I was doing this while I was in the middle of a pandemic, running as CEO, a turnaround and trying to raise $100 million. I was exhausted, but we did it. And for me, I can focus. And so if I moved myself to a different part of the house, we actually live on a farm and we have a guest house. So I would go out to my guest house with my cup of coffee and I would not talk to anybody. And I just focused on getting this book out and done. One of the things that helped me get my arms around it is that my father passed away in 2019, and I have a letter of his that I keep on my desk that he wrote when I was in my late 20s. And it was, I was having a very difficult time at work. You know, you're at a middle manager level, so you're not important enough that the people below you have to listen to you, and nobody above you has to listen to you. And his point was, challenge your crisis. And what he said is, every stumbling block ended up being the path to my greatest future. And so the book has that theme built throughout it, which is challenge your crisis, recognize that actually the stumbling block you have may be what accelerates you to the top.
Love it. I love peeling back layers here to learn a little bit more about you, and our listeners love to hear this. Look, you've been thriving throughout your career. It's storied. It's awesome. Adding, you know, Wall Street Journal and USA Today bestselling author title to your incredible list of accomplishments, which are only going to continue to rise throughout the accolades of your life, which means you're thriving on most days. But there are some times when you're not quite kicking on all cylinders and things aren't working the way you'd like them to. Lisa Gable, when you have trouble thriving, what practice do you seek, or maybe which individual do you seek out to get yourself back on the thriving track?
So when I have a bad day, I try to do one good thing for another person before I go to sleep. Mm. And what that might be is, I have a lot of young people and adults who come to me for both mentoring and also help with job hunting. And so I will sit down and go, okay, who can I help today? And before I go to sleep, I'll send out a couple of emails about this person who's looking for a job. Right now, as a matter of fact, I'm trying to help a young student to get a scholarship. Or if I don't even have anything like that in my little list of things to do, I will go onto LinkedIn and I'll seek out various people who could use a boost. You know, maybe it's a woman who's put a new article out there and she's trying to elevate attention to it. So I'll share the article, give her a call out. But by taking my angst and refocusing it before I go to sleep on having done a good thing, it just helps me stay grounded in what's important and how inconsequential the problems that I'm having that day are.
Well, a great perspective bit, and it does make you, and right before you go to sleep, I like that little touch on, you know, note to self, ask Lisa for favors late at night.
Well, and I can't sleep otherwise. What my husband will tell you is if I don't do that, I'm up at 3 o'clock in the morning writing. I get my best articles written when I have a problem, because at that point I'm just working through my brain, and I'll like finally get up and I'll go and write an article.
Love it. Lisa, let's do the admin part of the show, and then we're going to head down Fun Street. Share with the listeners where people can find you, learn about your book. We'll put it in the show notes, but it always gets more engagement when they hear it from you.
Yeah, so I am very active on LinkedIn. That's probably my largest audience. And also, if you send me notes, I do answer them. You can also find me on Instagram and Facebook under Lisa Gable Official. So look for me there. And again, we're pretty responsive because I want to help people. And it's just been a wonderful way to meet new people.
Spectacular. Lisa Gable, you ready to go down Fun Street here on Thrive Loud? I think you are.
I am.
Share with the listeners what you shared with me, although we don't necessarily put this maybe under the fun category, but this is definitely an amazing movie. Share with the listeners what you shared with me was your favorite movie.
So my favorite movie is When We Were Soldiers. And it's a movie with Mel Gibson where he is going into Vietnam, and he basically has a very small group of people up against, I think it was about 4,000 Vietnamese who were in the mountains. And it demonstrates a few things. What I like about it is the fact of they don't give up. They just keep moving forward. But it's also a lesson on teamwork. And the third element of it is that he focuses on when a bad thing happens, you're in charge, make an instantaneous decision. And there's this incredible scene where they're in the helicopter and he's doing a test case. And the first guy jumps off, he goes, you're dead. Next person, you're in charge. Next guy gets off, you're dead. Next person, you're in charge. And what he shows is that even at the lowest rank, that if you're the one that's the last man standing, you have the capacity to pick up the mantle of leadership and take care of those in your care. Yeah. And I think people don't realize that we have it within us. We really do. And history demonstrates that sometimes the most strong people are actually the people who are at the lower end of the ladder. I think it's one reason the Bible has David and Goliath, right? Yeah. You know, it's a continuation of history. But that's one reason I love the movie.
I love it. That's interesting perspective. And it also helps to understand a little bit about you in the sense of jumping into those crisis situations, which you've done throughout your career. Okay, we're going to do the speed round here in Fun Street, and I think you can handle this. This is how this rolls. I'm going to ask you something. I want the first thing that comes to your mind. These are things that lift you up, that motivate you, that make you feel good, that basically make you thrive.
Okay, I got to take a drink.
All right. Of late, a song that you love to listen to, or maybe one that pumps you up.
Boston, More Than a Feeling.
Ooh, classic. I like it. A favorite food that's not a dessert.
Sushi.
A favorite dessert.
Chocolates.
Any chocolates? Anything specific?
I love chocolate ice cream, especially when it's Ben and Jerry's with all the stuff thrown in. You know, if you get the fudge and the chocolate chips and you get the chocolate, that's really good.
Used to get those factory seconds from Ben and Jerry's, and they would have too much of something in there because it had too much weight problem. You get like a block of Heath bar. You have to find those. It's very hard to find.
I'll look for it.
An activity you wish you did more of?
I love to swim. And so when I can't swim, I miss it a lot. So we open up our pool and I sort of brave the cold, and luckily it's heated and I like to swim the most.
An activity you wish you did less of?
Worry and sleep less, because I worry. I am a worrier. My dad was too, you know, and I do wake up at 3 a.m. and I just can't go back to sleep.
Lisa, if I snap my fingers and you can be anywhere in the world, where are you?
Hong Kong.
Have you been?
25 times. I love Hong Kong.
25 times. My goodness. Yeah. That's got to be the record. And when was the last time you were there?
I was there back in, I think, the late 90s. I used to go a lot when I did business, and it was before 9/11. So you could, any place you go, you'd fly through Hong Kong. You could check your bag in the, you know, like in a cubicle type of thing. And I would take the taxi. I'd go in, I go shopping for the day, see friends for dinner. And then I'd take a late flight to my next meeting. That's how I got there so many times, is I just tagged it onto every single trip.
That's awesome. Lisa Gable, our turnaround mastermind. Thank you so much for coming on Thrive Loud today. We will put all the links for all the great stuff you're doing and your book, and we'll make sure we get promotions out there. But most importantly, thank you for coming on and sharing your story and spend a little time here on Thrive Loud.
Well, thanks for having me. It was so much fun.
Absolutely. And to all our listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep moving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
Listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Check us out on the web at thriveloud.com and follow us on Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, and Facebook at Thrive Loud. And check us out on the Good Pods app at Thrive Loud, where you can follow, listen, and connect directly to Lou and all of the Thrive Loud episodes. Thanks for listening.